As you must be aware, we are having this session to have an overview of what is PMP certification, how do we prepare for it, are we eligible for it. Now, to set some ground rules, just in case by any chance I get disconnected, maybe due to power going off, just allow like 5 to 10 minutes for me to connect to mobile hotspot and I can resume then. All right. This is the first time I'm being given the opportunity to partner with this NGO and conduct a session. About me, I'm Zayed. I'm a customer service team manager. I have about 7 years of experience, and this year in Jan, I completed my PMP certification. Right. So this is something I'm sure you are already aware about. The team, what's its vision, and how is the team helping people at various levels, be it students or professionals, to gain help from the people who are already in the field. So, like I said, the agenda for this session is to understand what is and why do you think we need a PMP certification. And what's the eligibility criteria for PMP? Not everybody is eligible. There are some criteria to be met before you go ahead and attend the exam. We'll discuss the eligibility criteria in detail. And what is a PMI membership? What are the benefits of a PMI membership? We'll discuss in brief about that as well. And what is the fees? This is not to scare you. For most of us, it may look that the fees is too high, but then trust me, this investment will go a long way. So I'll also let you know what's the fees. Do not get concerned just in case you're not expecting that fee to be high. And how do we apply for the examination? So it's a very detailed process. You need great understanding of how do you apply? Because a lot of your process to get PMP certified will depend on your application as well. So we'll get to understand the application process as well. We'll summarize and I'll share my experience of preparing for this PMP certification and what was my approach. And I'll be happy to share that with you just in case you wanna take it. And of course, we'll have a Q&A session towards the end. Just in case I'm not audible to any one of you, please do message the host. That's why let him know he can fix that. I'm hoping that everybody is able to hear me properly. All right, somebody. All right, thanks, Abed.
I request, Zahid, I request you to please speak a bit loud. Your voice is.
Sure. Is it better now? I'm
Yes,
just holding the mic very close to.
Yes,
All right. Great. Thanks for that. So let's get started. Just for you guys to know, I'm sure we have a very diverse set of people participating today. Few of you are just in the start of your career. A few must be already having experience in the industry, respective industries. So the intent is by the end of the session, people who are already experienced, for you it's gonna be a detailed information on what is PMP and how does it help. People who are just starting their careers, you need not worry. This will help you plan your career as well. So I know there is a diverse set of folks who have joined in. Now, what is PMP? PMP stands for Project Management Professional, as the name says. It's a credential which is to be given to people who clear the PMP examination. Now, a person who has a PMP certification, he demonstrates three things. So, if at all you see somebody who is a PMP certified personnel, you can trust him on those three things. One is the experience of being a project manager. So if somebody who's a PMP, by default, he needs to meet a experience criteria and only then he attends the exam. So he already has that experience. Second is the education. So by education, it does not refer to your core education, what you have studied, for example, engineering. For me, it was pharmacy. It's not that. Education in, you know, the project management. And the last thing is the skill and competency. So he has the skill and competency to manage, lead projects. So whenever you get to see somebody who, you know, says he's BMP certified, I'm sure you must have seen people on LinkedIn or on the web, they suffix their name with BMP. Now, like doctors, they prefix the name with DR. BMP certified folks, they suffix their name with BMP. So this is one of the very few credentials where you can add it to your name on maybe LinkedIn or any other website. So just to summarize, so this talks about three aspects. One is the experience that a person has, the education, and the skill and competency to, you know, lead projects. And this is the most sought, you know, the certification. So you also have other certifications like PRINCE2, which also is around project management, but this is the most sought certification globally. And somebody who's a professional here, who has already had like good experience in whatever industry, you must have come across people with a PMP certification. Now that tells your colleagues and your managers or the management that a person with a PMP knows what he's doing in the project, right? So anybody who has a PMP, I mean, they have a high demand in their own organization. You know, it's obvious that somebody in my team who's PMP certified is more likely to be picked up for a new project. So that's where, that's how it is in the industry. Why PMP? Do I need a PMP certification? You're gonna ask yourself. So you are the best person to, you know, answer that. Like I said, if you are into managing project, then yes. And if you meet the eligibility criteria, I would highly recommend you to go ahead and, attend the PMP certification exam. Because once you achieve the certification, there are high chances, like I said, you getting picked to, you know, manage a new project, right? And also, you know, global studies show that people with PMP, they earn 25% more than the non-certified project management professionals, right? So that's the reason many of the people go ahead and attend this PMP certification. So I'll share my experience here, right? I have a master's degree in pharmacy. And after completing my master's degree, I joined Amazon as a customer service associate. And within a year, I was promoted to a team leader and a team manager. So basically in my role, most of the time I spend is managing teams, but then I was assigned a team where besides managing the team, I was also responsible for, getting involved in too many projects. And that's how I grew my passion towards project management, because I was managing too many stakeholders and I really wanted to, you know, take it to the next level. And hence, after I studied what's the eligibility requirement, and after I felt that, yeah, I am now eligible, I went for the exam and I cleared it. Akhil has a question. Yeah, please go ahead, Akhil. You say expected now. Yeah, sorry.
Actually, I'm not allowed anyone to unmute themselves, or we can take the question at the end of the session.
Sure, that helps.
Park your questions aside. Once we are done with the session, you can ask your questions. I'll unmute you then at that time. Thank you.
All right, thanks. We'll take questions. Please hold on to your questions. Right. This is the reason I have done my PMP. Another thing that I have observed in my organization is whatever roles that were open for program managers or the project managers, although there is an eligibility criteria for applying to those roles, you know, the preferred qualification, most of the roles demanded, that's my observation, is the PMP certification, experience in project management, and then a PMP certification. And hence that led me to, you know, attend this certification. I'm sure you would also come across roles that require you to be either a PMP certified professional or experienced in project management. No, if you have a certification, there's nothing like it. So that already takes care of your experience, education, skill, and competency, like we discussed earlier. All right, moving ahead. The reason I mentioned first things first is the eligibility criteria. Like I said, not everybody is eligible. There are a set of criteria to be met before you go ahead and attend the PMP exam. We'll talk in detail about it. So for all of you, like I said, I'm sure there's a diverse team with varying experience. It's okay if you're not eligible here, but then by the end of the session, you would definitely understand what it takes for you to be eligible. And thus, you can accordingly manage, plan your career. Now, there are two aspects of it. One is you have a four-year degree, and you just have the second one being you just have a high school diploma or an associate's degree. Now, we'll discuss the first one. If you have a four-year degree, then you need to have 36 months. So 36 months is equivalent to 3 years of project management experience, where you are part of the project, leading project, coordinating on projects, right? And 35 hours of education. So 35 hours of education is common here, right? Be it you having a four-year degree or not, this is mandatory. Now, suppose you are not having a four-year degree, then you need to have 60 months of experience, project management experience. So that's the difference between you having somebody switched on the video, that's fine. All right. So I'm sure you people are clear on this, that what's the eligibility criteria? One, like I said, the education, 35 hours of project management education, and then 36 months of experience for a person having four-year degree, and 6 months of project management experience for a person who doesn't have a four-year degree. Now, it is very common for us, like for me as well. I at a given time, I may not be just involved in one project. Now, these days, in all organizations, not just in my organization, to my friends in other organizations as well, when I speak to them, at a given time, they have multiple projects that they are working on. So this slide helps you understand what in case I have two projects that I was handling at the same time. Now, if you see here, project one, I started in January and it ended by March end. So I spent 3 months on project one. So Jan, Feb, and March. And then I have a project two, which I started in Feb, and that ended by end of May. So here on project one, I spent 3 months, and on project two, I spent 1, 2, 3, 4. So if you add those months, it would come around to 7, right? But the question here is, what is the total project experience from project one and project two combined? So if I were to use these projects, project one and project two, can I show 3 plus 4 months, that totals up to 7 months as the experience? Now, if that is the thing that you are, that was your answer, then you are wrong here. So that's the reason it says that you should have non-overlapping experience. Now, this is an overlapping period. So in this period, I was managing two projects, but then this will be counted as one. So the answer to this question is, what is the total project experience for project one and two is basically 5 months. Yes. All right, sure. I'll try my best. I'm speaking loud. Thanks. All right. So, like I said, so you will not count this overlapping experience. So you just count that from Jan until end of May, you spent your time on these two projects. That will be 5 months and not 7 months. All right. If you have any questions, we can take it at the end. moving forward, so this is something I want you people to know, just in case you are working on multiple projects at the same time, those projects will count as one. All right. Like I said, 35 hours of project management training is mandatory. You may want to attend it offline, or there are other sources as well, online. I attended the training online from Simply Learn. Although I do not endorse Simply Learn here, I just want you people to know that I have done my training on Simply Learn online, and it helped. It was fine for me. Now, if you want to go for offline modes, you are okay to do so. But then here's the thing. You need to be sure that they are registered educational provider. That's called REP. So these are the institutes or mediums that have been approved by PMI. PMI stands for Project Management Institute. That's the body that is responsible for giving these certifications. So you have to be sure, whichever medium you go for, offline or an online mode, you need to be sure that they are the certified REPs from PMI. Yeah, Irfan, like I said, we'll cover about the fees as well. Just hold on. I mean, the next slides will help you. So I'll just give you an overview and the timeline of how the application process looks like. What's the timeline? Now, first thing that you need to do is start an application. So you register on the website, and after you give your contact details and also the education details. Education details here would mean the 4-year degree that I was talking about. So once you give those details, your application starts, right? Once you start the application, you have 90 days to complete your application. So that's not a worrying thing at all. But application process is not easy as it seems, right? It's not like any other application. I would say spend good time on the application, right? I spent like about 5 days. Reason being, I was making changes every now and then, and it's also better just in case you are applying, you get it reviewed by a PMP certified professional. So for me, there was a colleague of mine who was already PMP certified. I got it reviewed by him, and he suggested few changes which I had to eventually make, and it really mattered a lot. So you have to spend good enough time in the application process. Once you take whatever time, be it 5 days, 10 days, you have 90 days once you start the application to complete it. And after you submit the application, you know, there is a review done by the PMI team. Now it will take 5 business days. So they are gonna respond within 5 business days. Why is this review? So they will check if you are meeting the eligibility criteria. So if you are meeting the eligibility criteria, they can go ahead and approve. And in few cases, there is an audit that may be initiated by the PMI team. So here audit may refer to they reaching out to the contact person. So in the application process, you also have to mention the team that you work with. So there has to be a contact person. So for instance, I submitted like 7 project as the eligibility. So I need to submit a contact person details, their email address and the contact phone number for each and every project, which just in case your application is picked for audit, they will reach out to them and they will also ask you to provide more details about the project that you may have submitted. So that's the audit process. So thankfully my application wasn't picked for audit, but just in case yours is getting picked for audit, you need not worry, as long as you are sure that your experience and everything is correct, right? Now, after your, say for example, without an audit, your application was approved, or after the audit process was completed, they approved your application, then you get the link to go ahead and pay for the exam, right? And I'll discuss about the fees later. The moment your application is approved, you have 1 year to go ahead and attend the exam. So after your application is approved by PMI, you have 1 year duration to attend the exam. Now you may plan it after a couple of months after your application is approved or at your convenience. So after my application was approved, I immediately set the date within a month. You know, it may depend. So it's up to your comfort. Now the second part of this this thing on the right, this is something that right now I think it's not relevant. So after you get your certification, once you pass the exam, that certification is valid for 3 years, and within these 3 years you have to maintain that certification. You have to report your professional development unit, something where you are giving back to the community. Now the session that I'm taking is also a part of it. You have to attend webinars or also take part in improving your knowledge. So the second part I am not covering. So we'll focus on getting the certification. The second part is how you maintain the certification. Moving on. Somebody asked about the certification fee, right? Now, like I said, if you are a member, so if you are a member of Project Management Institute, then your fees is $405. That comes to around 30,000 rupees. Right. If you're not a member, then it comes to around 42,000. Right. I highly recommend you to become a member of PMI. We are gonna discuss the benefits of becoming a member of PMI. One, by this slide, you already know that there's a huge difference in the fees. Right. So you become a member and then apply for the exam. That's the better choice, sensible choice. What's the benefit of becoming a PMI member, right? And the PMI membership fee, I checked a couple of days ago, it was like 9,000. So you're still saving on some amount if you're becoming a PMI member and then applying for the exam, right? So if you become a PMI member, that membership is valid for a year, right? And what are the benefits that you get? So you get to download the PMBOK guide, PMBOK. So this is the, what do we call, Bible of project management. This is a textbook, everything is covered in that book. You can download a soft copy of PMBOK if you become a PMI member. The second benefit is you save on money. Like on the earlier slide, I mentioned how you can save on the PMP exam fee. So there are also other certifications that are provided by PMI. If you want to, attend those certifications, you want to clear those certifications as well, you will save on those certifications as well. And you get to attend free webinars. So trust me, I'm a member of PMI. Every week you get a lot of knowledge. They share links to webinar. If you are available, you can join. And also I've seen a lot of work that they are doing during the pandemic. Now, how COVID is affecting work, how COVID is affecting hiring. So these are the things that you get free access to. And you also get to, use the free tools and templates. For me, there was a tool developed and I was one of the people who got early access to the tool, right? So that way you also get access to tools and templates. The last one is you get to join a community where there are people who are already certified. There are people who are having huge experience, people from VP director level. There are people who are also starting their career, the aspirants who are PMP aspirants. So you get to join the community and learn a lot. And one of the benefits, this is a standard benefit. So you once you enroll for a PMI membership, you can join a local chapter. So in Hyderabad, there is a local chapter in Gachibowli. So you can join that team. So that local chapter these days, they are running a program called the Exam Prepper Buddy. So in that program, if you are a member as an aspirant, exam aspirant, what happens is they will assign a mentor or a guide for you who has already received his PMP certification, right? And that person will help you, prepare for the exam. So I recently, after clearing my PMP certification, I signed up for this program where I helped a person, prepare for the exam. And just a week back, he received his PMP certification as well. right? Those are the benefits of you becoming a PMI member. Moving on, like I said, application process has to be a very detailed one. Yeah, thank you so very much, Amina. All right. Yeah. The application process, like I said, I'm just giving you a glimpse of the application process. You know, this is my own application, a part of it. Khaled, Khaled, if you have anything, we can discuss in the end. If you can put it in the chat box. Is there a problem? There are two people who raised their hand. Okay. If there are any questions, then we can take it at the end, right? If there's anything, then you can ping Wahid separately if you have any issues hearing, right? Now this is my application, that how it looks, right? You know, this is just a summary of the project that I worked on, the overview, and here you have to put in the start and the end date. What was your role? Were you a program manager? Were you a team member? Were you a project contributor? You know, what was the industry? You know, the job title that you were working. So one thing that you have to note here is the contact name. So you have to, you know, provide a contact name. It could be somebody who can be a manager or the project sponsor whom you work with. So a person who should be able to vouch for you just in case your application is picked for an audit, right? So here I had to mention my manager's detail. You also have to go ahead and provide contact details like phone number and also the email address. And again, in the application process, you have to also mention the hours that you have spent in each phase of the project. Now, every project will have five phases. One is the initiating of the project. So you initiate a project and then plan a project, execute the project, you control and monitor the project, and finally close the project. So majority of your time goes into planning, executing, and monitoring and control. So a very less amount of your time goes into initiating the project and closing the project. So in that sense, you have to go ahead and furnish the hours that you have worked on that project, right? In case you want to, if you are going to apply for PMP, you can reach out to me or anybody who is already a PMP certified professional. I'm sure they will be able to help you. So we are gonna understand the phases of a project in detail later in the coming slides. So this is how your application looks like. So after you are completing the application, you submit it, and then you attend the exam. All right. The next slide talks about the exam pattern, right? So there are 200 multiple choice questions, right? And of those, 25 will be unscored. So even if you give the right answer or the wrong answer, you will not be scored on them. And you'd never get to know out of those 200, which of those 200 are the unscored questions. So you will never get to know, right? And the duration of the exam is 240 minutes. That's 4 hours. Might be you'll be thinking that it's too much. I mean, 4 hours you have to attend an exam. Trust me, not a single minute extra I felt when I was attending the exam. I felt those 4 hours also were very less. So you have to give in your best the entire 4 hours of the exam duration, right? And before the COVID, it was a center-based test where I had to go to a center in Begumpet and attend the test. Now, because of the COVID situation, the team has moved it to an online proctored test, so you can attend from your home as well, right? And everything in this slide and the presentation, it's the reference is PMI.org, the website for PMI. Information that's missing here or information you want to understand more, you can go to PMI.org. You will find the entire information there. So like I said, you will have five phases in a project. You initiate, plan, and then execute, monitor, and control, and close. Now, most of the projects, like almost like 92, if not more than 90% of your project will follow this distribution where you spend like about 13% of your entire time on each thing, and closing has the least amount of time you spend on a project. So closing, it's only just documentation and everything, you know, relieving the resource, I mean moving the resources back to the teams. So these are the two stages where phases where you spend the least time, and for the rest of the phases you spend the most time, and your exam questions will also, you know, follow this distribution. Like out of those 200 questions, about 13% of the questions will, test your skills or knowledge in the initiation phase. Similarly, the other phases as well. So your exam also follows the same pattern. I'll just give a brief understanding of what you are gonna learn in project management education, those for 30 hours of education. So you will get to learn, we already knowledge area, and each of the row is a process group. Now if you see this entire picture, there are 49 process groups. So each of the knowledge areas has processes, and if you check the entire sheet, you have like 49 process groups. Now let's take one example here. Cost. Let's take that example, cost management. So you do not have any process group in the initiation process group. So you do not plan the cost before the project charter is approved. So this is something that you do in the planning phase. So in the planning phase, you plan cost management. That basically talks about how you are gonna manage the cost. And then second thing is, how do you estimate the cost? So you will never have a fixed cost. You have to just estimate the cost. And then you, basis those costs, you have to determine a budget for the entire project. So that happens in the planning phase. So there is no process group for, cost management knowledge area in the initiation process group. Similarly, in execution, there's nothing related to cost since you have already planned everything about cost. And in the monitoring and closing, process group, you have this process called the control cost. So these are the various processes that you have to learn. There are 49 of those. I will discuss about one such process, which is called the develop project charter. This is the first and the foremost process under your project management. So any project that you handle, any project that is ongoing or which is to be initiated, the first step of it is developing a project charter, right? So in PMBOK, all these 49 processes, are designed in the ITTO format. So ITTO stands for input, tools and techniques, and output. So all these things that you see on the left, these are the inputs. These are the things in the middle within a box, which you see are the tools and techniques. And the last thing on your extreme right you see is the output. So each and every process. Now, by definition, process is an activity that which takes inputs and gives a output. So by the application of tools and techniques again. Now here, if you see what are the inputs, benefits management plan. So before you initiate the project, you need to be sure and you prepare a document. So the leadership will go ahead and prepare a document to understand what would be the benefits of the project be like. Who will measure the benefits? When will these benefits be available to us? At what time of the project, right? So that is an input to this process. And another input is the business case. So is there a business case? Do we really need this project? If yes, what is the business case for it? So why are we doing it? What's the purpose? What's the rationale behind doing this project? So these are the inputs to this process group. And again, the third input is agreements. Say for example, you are doing a project constructing a, let me take a very simple one. You are installing software in a IT company. For example, you are installing Tableau software. So there will be an agreement between the vendor and the party saying that you will install this 50 softwares. This is the time. You will also provide service. So that's called an agreement. So if that's that will act as an input for this process group. So once you take all these inputs, again, you have these two things, enterprise environmental factors and organizational process assets. So this is called EEFs, enterprise environmental factors, this organization, any other factor that may affect the project, you know, policies of an organization, right? Those are the things, or government policies as such that will affect the project. So you will also consider those, right? The last one is the organizational process assets. So these are the assets, like the name already says, OPAs. There's a short name to this called OPA. EEFs and OPAs, enterprise or environmental factors, and the OPAs. OPA, the project management office, which will provide the templates. So the organization will customize the templates as per their culture, and that will be available with the PMO team, project management office team, and you can use that for your project. So for example, somebody has already done a project in the past and you have that entire documentation, so that can be considered under organizational process assets. So that's an asset that you will make use of. Now in the tools and techniques, you will apply expert judgment. So if you are developing a project charter, a fresher cannot do this. Or maybe an experienced person from a different domain may not have the right judgment in creating a project charter. So you need to have an expert from that specific domain to help you develop a project charter. Gather the data. Like I said, there will be a benefit management plan. How will those metrics be defined? How will you gather those data? Say suppose there was a project done in the past, then maybe there is a scope for improvement. So you work on the data and gather it. Interpersonal and team skills. Now, while you are talking to experts, while you are calling for meetings, you need to possess this skill to manage any stakeholders, manage any conflict with the stakeholders. So these are the tools and techniques that you apply in the develop project charter process. And the output here is the project charter. So, sorry, project charter is a document which authorizes a project. Now, if you hear about this term project charter, that basically means the authorization of project by the management. And in the process of developing a project charter, you also appoint a project manager who will be responsible for leading the project. So most of the times, this activity is done by the leadership, organization leadership, and once the project charter is developed, you assign a project manager for this. The second output is the assumptions log. Assumption log basically means that you may have certain assumptions before you start a project. Like if I increase the resource headcount by 10%, I'll see a productivity increase by X percentage. So that's my assumption. So you need to record those assumptions as well. So later, if you have any changes, check. So this is an example of one of the processes. So there are 49 such processes under 5 process groups and under 10 knowledge areas, right? And each process, you have to refer the PMBOK, and every process will be in this ITTO format. And like I said, the output of this process will be an input to some other process, right? Your project charter will also be used in the other processes. So you have develop project management plan, direct and manage project work. So your project charter, the output of this process will be an input to some other process, right? We come towards the end of this. The references I took is the PMBOK and the website and the Simply Learn PMP study slides. Now I'm open to questions, right? Before that, I would take 5 minutes to help you, share my experience. There will be a lot of material. Now, if you go back and search the web, how do you prepare for a PMP exam? Let me tell you, you will get 20 such websites. Some of them offer free material. Some of them, offer it at a very low price, right? But trust me, there's nothing better than the PMBOK, right? Teamwork is the sole textbook for this project management. Everything that you need to know about project management will be available in Teamwork, right? If you are, covering 100% of Teamwork, you need not go for other materials. This is my approach that I took, right? If you are, and this is highly recommended, you know, there is no other option. You just cannot rely on material that is available on the web. So please go ahead and, you know, prepare from PMBOK. Now, after you, have completed, you know, going through PMBOK, I would say go ahead and attend the mock exams. Now, if you go ahead and, attend the training on Simply Learn, you also get some mock tests. And you have, so once you attend the test, you also can review and understand where you went right and where you went wrong. Now, a lot of time needs to be invested in the mock exams, right? You cannot complete 3 mock exams in a day. That's not possible at all. So if you are attending a mock exam, you need to spend 4 hours for attending the exam first, and another like 2 to 3 hours on evaluating what went right and on where you need to improve. So for what I would recommend is for each and every right and wrong answer, you go back to PMBOK, refer it, and understand where you went right and where you had the area of opportunity. That's very important. So this is also one of the suggestions from my end. Say, for example, you are sure that you are eligible for attending a PMP exam. The next thing I would want you to do is, go through the entire online module at once. So you have you can complete in like 3 to 4 days the entire module. If you are spending like 4 to 6 hours a day, you should be able to complete it in like 3 to 4 days. Now, once you have done that, I would say go back and again start the module. Now, this time complete one knowledge area in one day. Basically, you have 10 knowledge areas that will take you 10 days. Now, each day, once you complete a specific knowledge area, you have to go back and refer the PMBOK for that particular knowledge area. Say, for example, the first knowledge area that I need to learn is integration management, project integration management. So I completed online from Simply Learn or whatever website. And then again, I come back and review the entire PMBOK for that knowledge area. So that way, yeah, your knowledge will increase definitely. That helped me as well. Now, whatever way you find is helpful, please go ahead. But the most important thing that you need to remember whenever you are preparing for PMP is the discipline. You need to have a schedule and a discipline for that. You cannot procrastinate and say, I will complete. Today I had some priorities. I couldn't stick to the schedule. I will cover it up in the coming days. That's not going to happen. Trust me, it will build on the frustration. That's my experience. Yeah, we'll open it for questions. Hope this was helpful for you. Yeah, the latest edition of PMBOK is the 6th edition, right? And there was a revision due around June, but due to COVID, there is no revision happening right now. If there is a revision, you will get to know it on the PMI.org website. Does assumption lock come under brainstorming? No, brainstorming is a tool and technique. Now, brainstorming, for example, you need to get ideas. So you can have 10 people in a room. You can have 10 people on a call to get those ideas. So it's a tool and technique, while assumption lock is an input or an output. Where you will upload? Father asks, are you referring to the PPT slide? You need to be a little more elaborate.
I can. Ani here. Can you hear me, Zahid?
Yeah, I can hear you. Please go ahead.
Zahid, actually, to be frank, actually, I am trying since many years for this PMP. I discontinued. Mm-hmm. Basically, I have around 10 plus years of experience. So, see, the main question was, what I heard is after June, they are going to change the syllabus. They are going to add some agile.
Sorry, I just your voice is breaking. If I understand it correctly, you're asking whether there was a revision that happened in June.
Yeah.
So like I said, there was a revision due in June. You know, they were moving to the 7th edition, I'm sure. But then it's put on hold due to the COVID situation.
So do you know, I mean, any tentative plan if this year it will happen or it will happen next year?
What I can do is I can contact my local chapter. Can I get your name?
Yeah, Muhammad Aman Rizvi.
Yeah, man. So what I can do is I can contact the local chapter, you know, and check with them. You can follow up with me just in case I forget. I'll get back to you. I'm sure because of the COVID situation, it's not going to happen very soon. But just in case there is a revision also happening.
Yeah.
There is
Wasim here. Just to add on, because I am writing the exam as well. So the PMP is going to revise to the next edition in January 2021. So we have another
Left. Yeah, that's what I was about to tell. So if there is a revision happening, I'm sure they will let you know 6 months in advance. So January, basically, you still have 6 months.
Yeah.
I'll definitely get it confirmed. So if you are planning for a PMP certification, I would say the ideal time for you to prepare is 3 months. Let me tell you why. You have to earmark 1 month for your mock exams. That's for sure. And I would say 1 month to be on the safer side for just in case your application is right. So and 1 month for your preparation.
Okay.
So basically, it's 1 month for your application, 1 month for your preparation for the exam, 1 month for your mock test. Trust me, mock test will help you a lot. It will give you a true picture where you stand in terms of the preparation. Yeah.
Do we have any free sources for mock tests or all are paid?
If you go for Simply Learn, you already get like 7 to 8 mock exams. And once you register and pay the fees with PMP, you also get one test from PMP, right? Mm-hmm. And also you can go to Udemy, right? And you get a set of 3 mock tests for about, say, 500. So it's manageable there. So
will they review and the answers which they suggest, will that be
Udemy,
correct?
I mean, Udemy. Yeah. So this is what happens in Udemy. So if you take that mock test, you know, after each and every mock test, you get the option to review. And for each and every question, you also have the reference. Say, for example, you know, available, so you get
okay. And just my last question, like if we compare Print 2 and PMP, what do you think, like which we should go for? Because Print 2 is comparatively a bit easy, and in Print 2 we have two options. One is normal Print 2 and another is
Print 2
Agile. There is no foundation practitioner are in both. There is one Print 2 that is normal, that is the traditional one, and there in since few years we have Print 2 Agile. In Print 2 Agile also we have foundation and practitioner. So think, like now, if we compare these three certifications, what shall we choose?
I may not be the right person to answer this. We'll have to pick somebody who has vast experience and somebody who has like 10 to 15 years of experience. But for me, this is what is my understanding is Prince certification is very, very much in demand in the UK market, right? Where there is a lot of challenge with the environmental impact and all. So, but trust me, PMP, I think it's a very useful and, accepted globally. I think I would always go for PMP, but then I would recommend you taking input from people who are highly experienced in this.
Okay.
Sorry about that. Want to be very honest on this.
Yeah. Thank you so much. Yeah.
Lahir bhai, the one who is having questions and which is not related to this webinar, they can directly ping me on WhatsApp with their query name. Profession and the query. I'll revert them back. on WhatsApp, inshallah. Thank you.
Let me just pick the questions here. Can freshers think of getting a PMP? Is there an experience barrier that needs to be fulfilled? Khalik, yeah, there is an experience requirement. It's not just your work experience. Your experience in leading projects is required. So if you have a four-year graduate degree, then you need to have 3 years of non-overlapping experience. So you should do a little more research. Yeah, but then if you are a fresher, I think you can plan your career accordingly. Yeah, I get to see a lot of feedback. Informative session. Thanks. Great session. Thanks for the feedback, Manoj. Can you share the PPT? Yeah, of course. If you can send in your details, I can definitely forward the PPT. Feedback link. I'm really not sure. This is the first time. I'm really not sure if there's an option for a feedback link. But you are welcome to share the feedback over my email or my phone number. I'll share those details in a minute. Please share the same at CG Group Server. Yeah, I will do that. Nice session from Isaac. Thank you so very much. And Isaac, if this happens to be my senior at Amazon, he's a senior program manager, highly experienced in project management. Thanks, Isaac Bhai, for that feedback. And thanks for attending. Really encourages me. How to register PMI and this member is permanent or renewable? Khadir, Abdul Khadir, it's not permanent. It's a renewable thing. So the credential is valid for 3 years. And by the end of third year, you need to submit 60 PDUs. There's a criteria for your certification to be continued. So right now, if you're not already certified, you shouldn't focus on this. After you getting certified, you can definitely think of it. After PMP certify, how's the job opportunities in market, Hyderabad market, Vaseem? Like I said, Vaseem, this is my experience as well. I changed my career domain. Like I basically had my education in pharmacy. I hold a master's degree, but then I joined Amazon and I really liked the job and hence stayed at Amazon. And in my job, apart from handling a team, I'm also, expected to manage project, small size or mid size projects, and that's how I grew my passion. And when I used to browse jobs within Amazon, there's a lot of preference given to the folks with experience in project management. So if you have a PMP certification, there's nothing like it. I am sure you will be prepared with the other people. When can we expect the next session? Says Sayed Anwar. I think the CGC team will answer that. And how different is Guru Prasad asks, how different is PMP from CAPM? Let me tell you, I'll take this opportunity. We have like 5 minutes. So there are different certifications offered by PMP, not just this. There's this. So this is the ground level where you are certified project management professional. So project is something closely related activities. It's a temporary endeavor you take, and you have a finished product or a service or a result at the end of the project. For example, construction of a flyover. So you have a time period, you construct a flyover and it comes to an end. That's a project, right? And then you also have a program. Program is a collection of related project. So if I have a construction of a flyover, I have construction of an underpass. These are two projects that are going on to enhance the commute time maybe in Hyderabad. Then that's that collection of projects can be regarded as a program. Now there's another thing called the portfolio. Portfolio is a collection of programs and also operations. For instance, operations is something like a GHMC, cleaning of roads, laying of roads. So that's an ongoing process that never ends. Every now and then they keep. So cleaning of roads is done on a daily basis. So that's operations, something which never ends in an operation. So combination of operations plus combination program is called a portfolio. Now there are different levels of certifications. Guruprasad, you can definitely go to pmi.org. You will get to know in details. There are like 7 to 8 certifications. There's certification in business analysis. There's certification in scheduling. There's certification in risk management. So these are the various types. So certified associate in project management is a little different from PMP. You know, you can get more details there on the website. Vaseem says, thank you for the nice session. Salman says, nice. Thank you. Can't wait for the next session. Thank you so very much. Really encourages. All right. There are other questions. A couple of minutes. Very well explained. Okay. Faridbanu, very informative session. Thank you. Thanks, Faridbanu. For a fresher, what would be the first step? The PMP. Now, what I would say is, do not go for certification. That's not the way to approach this. What I would say is, focus in your career. If you are very fresher, if you get a job, you should focus in your job. Wherever you are provided opportunities to take part in projects, that's how you should start your experience in project. So do not think of a certification in the beginning. That's my suggestion. Abdul Razak says, how about referring Rita for preparation? Your experience, your expert opinion would be appreciated. Abdul Razak, like I said, if you are sure that you have completed the entire PMBOK, I don't think there is a need for anything else apart from the mock-ups. Now, having said that, Rita also helps a lot. You can definitely go ahead and refer. And this is my experience, that I did not refer Rita. And I scored really well in the exam, in all the process group. But if you think you need Rita, please go ahead. Go for it, as long as you are disciplined. But I would highly recommend, first finish the PMBOK and then go for any other resources. Yeah, we'll share the PPT. Amina says, my husband and I want to write the exam. Do you think it's going to register for the exam together? Do we get any discount? No, there's nothing as such, family discount. I heard in a second attempt, there's a discount. So I'll tell you, so after your application is approved, you are allowed to attend the exam within a year after your application is approved. And you can have 3 attempts within 1 year. 3 attempts doesn't mean that those will be free 3 attempts after you pay the $400 fees, right? If you fail in the first attempt, you have to pay a specific amount. So do not even think of failing the exam and then clearing it in the next attempt. And there is no such option like the government of Telangana is calling off intermediate supplementary exams and everybody passes. There is nothing as such for PMP, at least. Prepare well and clear it on the first attempt. That suffice, as I'm a business alone. Thanks, Guru Prasad. I hope I answered your question. I'm trying to start back in testing and business analytics will PMP be required for me now. Zoya Alam, I really don't understand. I don't have knowledge about testing. What testing are you referring to? Maybe it's a software testing or ETL testing. But whatever it is, what I would recommend is you should speak to seniors in your organization and check somebody who has a PMP certification. Did it help them, right? And that's how you should get your answer. I'm so sorry, I'm not the right person to answer that. I will not do justice if I answer that, right? Where can we find online PMP mock test exam? Vaseem, go ahead and just type online free PMP mock exams. You'll get a lot of them. Don't worry about it. Thanks, guys. Anyway, latest questions I've attended. No, there's for each and every person, the questions are different. So you will never get, sample papers. Like we get it for your academics, like 2008 GATE paper. No, we are not getting that. How many times PMBOK to read before? Vaseem, till the time you reach your confidence levels, you should go ahead. And till the time you are scoring well in the mock exams, you should read PMBOK. Also, last question, Guru Prasad says, what are the project management domains which are covered in PMP? See, this is not restricted to any domain, IT domain or some specific domain. No, it's not domain specific. You can you know, so this is the template you can use in any domain, healthcare domain as well, right? That's how it is, software domain or whatever. Yeah, software testing. Yeah, as well, like I said, please speak to your colleagues who are experienced. From where we can get PDUs. PDUs is something that you did not go and get it somewhere. For example, you are 35 hours of project management education is equivalent to 35 PDU. So if you are submitting a training completion certificate, that basically means that you are submitting PDUs. Mozam Ali says, if someone is working as a team lead and not involved in all the five phases, is he still eligible? The answer is, Mozam Ali, no, that doesn't make you a complete project member. So please see to it that you are getting involved in all those five phases. That helps you in your, you know, expanding your horizon as a project member. And trust me, you have to go ahead and mention what you did when you're showing an experience that I was involved in this project. It's not that you tell about only four phases and leave one. You have to mention what you did in each of those phases. So it's very important to get experience in all the five phases. Can somebody working for the process but not the project can also take them? No, I think you have to have end-to-end experience. No, I don't think project happens in terms of a process. No, project is a project. You will have many processes within a project. So if you're only involved in a process, no, that will not help. See to it that you are performing well in your current role and speak to your management to show your interest in getting taking part in a project. That will help. So we are done with the time. I really thank you all for making this session very interesting. Thanks for those questions. Here is my email ID and contact number. Just in case you have anything, you can WhatsApp me or drop an email with the feedback. All right then.